Thank you, Ray. Thank you, Hans. And before I start, I want to thank Marla Dubinsky, who was kind enough to provide me with a lot of these slides. I'm going to talk for the next 20 minutes or so about kind of the state of what we know about the use of therapeutic drug monitoring in IBD. Here are disclosures. You can read them more in more detail in the book. And what I really want to talk about is try to arrive at an understanding between about the relationship between the pharmacokinetics, meaning the levels and how the drug is distributed, and the pharmacodynamics, how the drug works, as well as adverse events, and also to think hard about the role of therapeutic drug monitoring in treating IBD. And there are limitations to what we know. And I'm going to bring you back to medical school to remind you that drugs have this profile. This is the classic curve. There's a time after you give the drug till it reaches its peak, its maximum concentration, the Cmax and the Tmax. There's the area under the curve as the drug is metabolized and eliminated through various methods. And in addition, there is this notion of a therapeutic range for most drugs. Now, we are latecomers to this concept in IBD, but we know this better for the thiopurines, and I'll talk about them only briefly and focus on the biologics where we know somewhat less. But the concept is there's a minimum effective concentration at the bottom, and below that you have lack of efficacy. And then at the top you have the maximum therapeutic concentration, and above that, in theory, you have toxicity. Now, one thing that I'll tell you at the outset is for biologics, unlike compound-based drugs, we don't have a lot of evidence that giving more drug produces more toxicity, and that's an interesting notion to consider. So just keep that in the back of your mind. So we'll start as a model, and I won't spend too much time on this because Marla did in the last session, on what we know about the thiopurines. And to make a long story short, what we know is that patients who have higher levels, and generally levels above 235 or 250 for 6-thioguanine, are more likely to respond to these medications. So that gives you a target, at least a minimum threshold that you would like to achieve. Marla also mentioned this study, which gets to the notion of using metabolite testing as a way of optimizing therapy. So this is really classic therapeutic drug monitoring. The question is, if you really put therapeutic drug monitoring in place in your clinical protocols, can you do better for patients by keeping them in that therapeutic range rather than flying by the seat of your pants and dosing according to weight? Now, unfortunately, it's really quite unfortunate that the study never really recruited well, because you can see these trends with just 27 patients who completed out of a planned 226 patients who were supposed to be randomized, and you get this sense that it might have been good to do individualized dosing over weight-based dosing, but unfortunately we just don't have the answer. So I like this slide because it really sums up what we know about checking thiopurine metabolites, and this is a slide from Miles Sparrow, who's written a lot on this topic of thiopurines. And what he feels, and I agree, is that the best use of thiopurine monitoring is for patients who are not responding to treatment, or potentially patients who are experiencing adverse events, even if they're on adequate weight-based doses. And you get these scenarios. The patient who is not responding, they may have no 6-thioguanine and no 6-methylmercaptopurine. Look, you've discovered that the patient is actually not taking the drug. They're non-adherent. Then you have the patient who does have some drug, but the levels are low for both metabolites, and that's simply a case of underdosing. So the message there is clear: you can updose that patient. Or it's possible that the patient is partially compliant, and you can confront the patient and say, are you really taking all your medication? And if not, maybe you should be. Then you get the patient who has low 6-thioguanine, high 6-methylmercaptopurine, and Marla has taught us through her work that these patients are generally thiopurine resistant. Some people would suggest that down dosing very considerably, as Ed told you, on the thiopurine and adding allopurinol could be an effective way of overcoming this issue. But I really generally don't recommend that people do this because of the potential myelotoxicity. Then you have the patients who are in therapeutic range for the metabolites, and they're not responding. They have active inflammation. These are truly thiopurine refractory patients, and you should move on. And then you have people who are high range, high 6-thioguanine, high 6-methylmercaptopurine. You're probably overdosing those patients. What's too high, probably a 6-thioguanine above 450 is higher than necessary. You could probably down-dose those patients. So that's how I think about it. Now, when it comes to biologic therapies, there are a lot of questions here about therapeutic drug monitoring. First of all, what is the relationship between the exposure to the drug and to the response? Have we defined that? Can we define a minimum effective concentration here? Is there actually a maximum therapeutic concentration where we'll see no additional benefit on the one hand, or maybe we might even see increased toxicity? Now, I'm going to make a long story short here and tell you that I did the most exhaustive literature search that I could find, even looking for abstracts, and I could find no evidence whatsoever that supratherapeutic doses or levels of anti-TNFs produce more toxicity, even though that is a theoretical concern. I could not find a shred of evidence of that, and I would be happy if someone could provide such evidence of that and tell me that. We'd also like to know what is the relationship between drug concentration and anti-drug antibodies, and because that's a unique aspect that you don't find with compound-based drugs. And how should this affect the treatment strategy? Is it cost-effective to measure drug levels and use that to guide therapy? And basically, what are the situations in which you should use it? Is it in the induction phase, the maintenance phase, loss of response, toxicity, or when you're retreating after a drug holiday? So we'll talk about each of these things. So first, defining a therapeutic level for, in this case, we're starting with infliximab. Here we have really old data, more than 10 years old, where we understood that in general, patients who had higher levels of infliximab in circulation had a longer duration of response than the patients who had lower levels. And this is an older ELISA-based assay, and the cut point here was 12 micrograms per ml. These are also cross-sectional data in a sense. You have data from Sonic, where clearly we understood the role of combination therapy in maintaining high infliximab levels. But quite apart from that, you get a notion of what a shouldering effect above which you see a higher therapeutic response. And here the cut point was somewhere between 1 and 3 micrograms per ml, and this is at week 30, the concentration. So it's another piece of cross-sectional data suggesting 1 to 3-ish should be good, at least at a later time point. We have these data from Alana Mazur, who's at Mount Sinai and was at Mount Sinai in Toronto, now in New York. And this is more Crohn's disease data, and basically remission rates and endoscopic improvement shouldered around 2 to 3 as a concentration that seemed to be most optimal. And you don't see any much additional effect above that. We have these data. Again, cross-sectional data, looking at trough levels at numerous different time points, and showing that the patients who had mucosal healing with Crohn's disease, the ones who had complete mucosal healing had a higher level, more like 5 or 6 than 3. The ones who had partial healing had something closer to 3, and the ones who had no healing had obviously very little drug in circulation. You get to another question. So most of the data that I've just shown you are cross-sectional in nature. But the question is, if you measure a drug level at an early time point, what does it mean for later outcomes in the disease? And this is one look at that from the ACCENT-1 data, looking at measures of week 14 serum infliximab levels and trying to predict, show whether they're associated with sustained clinical outcome at the end of a year. And if you look at the second line there, the patients who had drug level higher than 3.5 micrograms per ml at week 14 were much more likely, roughly 2 times more likely, to have a sustained response at 1 year than the ones who had a level lower than 3.5 micrograms per ml at week 14. And that was statistically significant. One more look, another way of looking at it, this is receiver-operator curves, work done by Barrett Levesque at University of California, San Diego. You can see that the sensitivity and specificity of these cut points, which are somewhere around 3, again, a common theme, 3 micrograms per ml, were somewhat reasonable for sensitivity and specificity for CRP as an outcome measure and for a response, the CDAI. You see that here. Now, what about ulcerative colitis? So far, I've talked about Crohn's disease. Is the story any different in ulcerative colitis? And long story short, it's not terribly different. Patients who, first of all, have detectable drug levels as opposed to undetectable drug levels do much better in terms of remission rates as well as endoscopic improvement. And hearkening to your pre-test question, that's a hint to listen now, the presence of detectable trough infliximab levels reduces colectomy rates in ulcerative colitis. In fact, it's roughly 7 to 8-fold higher risk of colectomy if you don't have drug in circulation. And there's growing concern that particularly in severe ulcerative colitis, the needs for drug may be much higher early on because there seems to be a lot of TNF in circulation. And we've never individualized dosing according to measurements of levels of TNF because the serum TNF has actually been very hard to measure in assays, at least up to this time. So now we look at data from Act 1 and Act 2, and this is an interesting look. If you look not in the blue box, but at week 8, you'll see that these are quartile measures of drug levels, and even at week 8, the patients who had the highest quartile levels of trough infliximab or infliximab levels tended to do better. You see this trend of higher clinical remission rates with higher trough levels, even early on. But look how high those levels are early on. They're in the range of, at lowest, in the 20s up to as high as 50s and beyond. But at week 30, we're looking at much lower levels. We're looking at kind of a shouldering of the effect, maybe somewhere around 3-ish again to somewhere around 7-ish. That seems to be the sweet spot here, beyond which you don't get very much more efficacy at later time points. And so it's been proposed by Bill Sanborn from this work that you may have seen already, when you're looking at a patient who has had loss of response to infliximab, the question is, how can drug levels be useful? And the patients who have subtherapeutic concentrations of infliximab do well with upping the dose of infliximab. The patients who have human anti-chimeric antibodies probably are better served switching to another agent. And you see this here. We're assuming, of course, that you've evaluated the patient to make sure that they literally do have inflammatory disease driving their symptoms. Otherwise, you could be chasing drug levels and changing drugs empirically without knowing that you're actually treating active disease. So that's a very critical point. What about adalimumab? I've talked a lot about infliximab. We know a lot more about infliximab than we do about adalimumab drug levels. And here are just a few pieces of literature that I pulled out here. And in general, you see the same message that people with higher levels of adalimumab and people who don't have antibodies to adalimumab or ATA, or as they're sometimes called, AAA, antibodies against adalimumab, has nothing to do with the automobile club. You see that patients with higher drug levels do better and patients who don't have antibodies against the drug do better. And as with all biologics, at least anti-TNFs, combination use with immunosuppressants means that you're going to have higher drug levels and you're less likely to have antibodies against adalimumab. But here, the levels that we're talking about, remember, this is a drug dosed every 2 weeks, every week. So the troughs, you're going to get less big, not as dramatic swings in the drug levels. With infliximab that you're giving every 8 weeks, you're getting these big seesaws of drug and then drop. With adalimumab, you probably are going to get more steady state, and there aren't going to be as dramatic differences. In general, you see this message here, same message. Here, the cut point was adalimumab levels of 5.85 micrograms per ml seem to be roughly optimal. Not terribly different, actually, from what I told you from infliximab. You see the sensitivity and specificity here of 68%, 71%. But look at that positive likelihood ratio. It's only 2.3, which means that it is not highly predictive of who is going to respond and who isn't. So if you're using it as a clinical test, it may not be as valuable. Here again, you look at mucosal healing in relationship to adalimumab trough levels, and you get the same message from this other cohort that roughly 5-ish is the level that seems to be most optimal. But what I show you here is also pulled from the same paper, and once again, somewhere a dividing line around 5 seems pretty good, but look at the overlapping spread of these populations with mucosal healing and no mucosal healing. There's a tremendous amount of overlap, even around 5. So I'm not sure how discriminatory this level of 5 really is for adalimumab. And this paper, maybe it's a different assay, I'm not sure, uses a much lower trough level. But again, it's the same message. The patients who have the higher trough levels do better for longer in terms of clinical response than the ones who have very low trough levels. So there's been a proposed algorithm, just as there has been with infliximab, for adalimumab now, and it's along the same theme. If patients have a high trough adalimumab and they've lost response, you should switch to another therapeutic class. They're probably not responding to the drug. If they have low trough levels and they don't have antibodies against the drug, maybe you could increase the frequency of dosing or increase the dose altogether. And if they have low trough but they have antibodies against the drug, and here the trough should be lower than 4.9 or 5, and antibodies in the range greater than 10, then you might want to switch to a different anti-TNF. That's been proposed, not been prospectively validated. And here we talk a little bit about the role of antibodies against the biologic. So what is probably most paramount is the level of the drug. But the level of the antibodies or the presence of antibodies is also independently associated with negative outcome. And patients who have a higher trough do much better, but patients who don't have antibodies to infliximab also do better. And if you have antibodies to infliximab, you do worse. And you see this in the bar graph in the lower left-hand side, where in the green bar, you can see that even the patients who had circulating infliximab, if they had antibodies to infliximab, they didn't do nearly as well over the long haul as the patients who didn't have the antibodies but had drug in circulation. And so this brings us back to when you should actually measure levels. And this is a question whether we should be more intensively measuring levels early in the course of the disease. So here's a patient, very sick with UC, and the patient is dosed week 0-2-6, standard dosing. You can see the serum infliximab level is dropping and dropping. Even in the first 2 weeks, you see the drug dropping very dramatically, although there are still pretty good levels. They're pretty low by the time you get to week 14. And then by the time you get to the week 6 infusion, the drug is basically at zero. And then in the green bar, you see that the anti-infliximab antibodies are rising very dramatically. So what's happened here is you've tanked out, there's no drug, and now you've reintroduced infliximab, and you've basically immunized the patient against the drug. So this raises the question whether, particularly for very sick patients, certainly with ulcerative colitis, maybe we should be more intensively dosing early, maybe we should be measuring drug levels very early in the course of treatment to make sure that we get it right. Even though you don't see any difference in the middle there in the area under the curve of infliximab concentrations between endoscopic responders and non-responders at week 8, there is still a feeling that early on the differences that you see are going to make really matter for the longer haul with these patients, and that patients who develop antibodies to the drug that can be detected even in the presence of circulating drug using a homogeneous mobility shift assay, those patients are not going to do as well. There are many factors now that are known to affect drug levels, but there are no good models to predict who exactly is going to have lower drug levels and what the pharmacokinetics are going to be. We've talked about the presence of anti-drug antibodies. We've talked about the importance of concomitant immunosuppressive use. What we cannot really measure is high baseline TNF as yet, but the very sick patients with very hot IBD are the ones who are likely to have very high levels of TNF and probably will need more drug. Having low albumin is associated with higher rate of clearance. And in fact, we now know that there are measurable amounts of drug, infliximab, in the stool in patients with severe steroid refractory UC who are getting the drug, they're basically just pouring the drug out of their bowel. And so they have very low levels, and that correlates very highly with a low albumin. Patients who have a high CRP are also likely, that's a surrogate for high TNF, and body size may have an effect, and gender, males have a faster clearance. I'm going to skip through this. This basically shows you what I showed you with infliximab, but it's also true with adalimumab. So the point of this, and this is one patient who got dosed with infliximab, bottomed out a level, developed antibodies to infliximab, and then was switched to adalimumab, and the same thing happened. So one question is, are patients who develop antibodies to one drug, are they more likely to develop antibodies to their next drug, and therefore should you be more careful with those patients when you introduce that next drug? We don't have many examples of prospective therapeutic drug monitoring optimizing therapy with biologics, but we have a couple now that I'll tell you in the last few minutes. So this is from Adam Chaffetz's practice at Beth Israel Deaconess in Boston, and for a long while it's been his practice to monitor drug levels and to try to keep his patients in a range of 5 to 10 micrograms per ml, which I told you might be the sweet spot. And lo and behold, when he looked backward at his data, the patients who had dose optimized seemed to do much better than the patients who had not had dose optimization. And you see that in both of these curves. So that's one experience, one practitioner. There is now one prospective study called TAXIT, which has been reported, but not fully published yet. And this had a couple of phases. It was a complex study. These were patients with Crohn's disease or with ulcerative colitis who were going on to infliximab, and in the optimization phase, they had dosing based on a drug level, trying to get the range between 3 and 7 micrograms per ml. That was the optimization phase. So everyone was brought to the same level, and then they were randomized to have dose optimization to continue, level-based group, LB at the bottom, or a clinical-based group, just changing doses based on clinical judgment of who's not responding. So that was the maintenance phase. So first, the optimization phase. Well, what you see here on the left is that patients who were optimized, who had Crohn's disease, did better when their drug level was optimized. That effect was, interestingly, not seen in the 28 patients who had dose optimization who had ulcerative colitis. So it's not really clear why that is, and you can see pretty much the same effect in dropping CRP concentrations on the right. Parenthetically, this is a different study. One interesting concept is whether the change in infliximab after you dose optimize, or the rate of change, the delta, might be most predictive of how the patient is going to respond. That's at this point a concept introduced here. But it's not fully fleshed out and fully validated as yet. Now, bringing us back to TAXIT, here's the maintenance phase. Well, somewhat disappointing. Basically, the clinical-based group and the level-based groups performed exactly alike. There was no difference here with regard to the primary endpoint of clinical remission. If you looked at the survival curves in the maintenance phase, time to loss of response and need for an intervention, there you saw that the clinical-based group had a much higher need for rescue than the patients who had level-based dosing. So the secondary outcome was positive, but that was not the primary outcome. It was at least pre-specified. But one question is, you know, a lot of these patients who had level-based dosing in the TAXIT study actually had down dosing because their levels were above the goal target at the top. And so, would it be actually cost-effective to do therapeutic drug monitoring? At least in one analysis of this done by Steenholt, they modeled this and actually they looked at this in a cohort, and that they found that with a relatively inexpensive drug monitoring assay, that actually was cost-effective. I think a lot of this has to do with the cost of the assay. The last topic that I'll touch upon is, can you use anti-drug antibodies and trough levels to predict who can safely resume infliximab after a long drug holiday? And the time to do this is not before not really necessarily before you give the drug after the holiday, but it's after you dose it. And what they basically found is the presence of antibodies to infliximab after the second infusion being detectable predicted not likelihood of response. Immune modulators at restart were good. They helped preserve response. If the reason for discontinuation was the patient was in remission or they had a pregnancy, not for loss of response or an infusion reaction, patients generally did well. And if the trough level was above 2 after the retreatment, then the patients tended to do well. So there are lots of questions that I posed here, and I've provided some answers, but maybe more questions than answers. Additional questions could be, should we target different trough levels at different phases of treatment? The rate of early drug clearance really seems important in severe disease, and we might want to measure more intensively there. Do you need a higher trough level in induction than in maintenance? The answer seems to be likely yes. Would the rate of early drug clearance be clinically useful as a parameter? Early data suggests maybe. Should we actually individualize therapeutic drug monitoring based on, for example, the target TNF levels? We don't know. Is there a safety benefit to dose reduction for supertherapeutic levels? The data I find suggests probably not, but maybe someone will provide us evidence with that. Also, there are a lot of questions about the timing and frequency of therapeutic drug monitoring. How often should you do this? Please don't ask me this question. I don't know. How do we actually maximize the value? So, in conclusion, therapeutic drug monitorings with biologics are more complex than with thiopurines. We generally have this sense that a minimum effective concentration, at least in the maintenance phase, is a trough of infliximab of 3-ish to 5-ish and an adalimumab trough of 5-ish. The role in assessing loss of response is the best established role. It seems to be cost effective depending on the cost of the assay, but only when you are willing to reduce the dose of the drug and saving cost on the drug. So there's a lot of interest in this and in early dose optimization in severe disease. So that's where things stand. Next year, I'm sure we'll have a bunch more data, and thanks for listening.
Thanks, Bruce.